Unapku Production.
It is a different view, a different experience of our existence. I saw, certainly, I mean, I realized how wonderful our Earth is. I felt newborn, a big newborn, and even the next day when I went in the garden, the world was new. It was walking and beautiful May morning. Suddenly, I stopped and I had the feeling everything had changed. The wood was beautiful, beautiful green, and I had the feeling that I saw now the wood as it really is. And I had the feeling I would be included by it. I had a feeling of happiness I had never had before. And this gave me the security that if you have open eyes, you may see the world in a different way. You see it as it really is wonderful.
This member of the mushroom family, this fungus, is for the moment known only as X. It was discovered barely weeks ago growing in a remote rainforest. Science has not yet given it a name, for science knows scarcely anything about it. But it is felt that X might have one remarkable quality, that it stimulates extrasensory perception, enabling the mind to become telepathic and clairvoyant. Now, that's a rather large claim. Is it true or false?
They are written in French, in Spanish, in English. Here's one that says, mushrooms, Russia, and history. They're written in Syrian, Japanese, all the languages of the world. And they're all concerned with one thing, the same thing. The riddle of the sacred mushroom.
As for the mushroom, it took me out into worlds I didn't believe existed. Far beyond ordinary perception. And yet, even today, they're as real and as important to my everyday life as anything I've experienced.
The chemicals in the mushrooms, I think, will offer us another tool by which we can explore the mechanisms and the capabilities of the mind of man, and that's both sensory and extrasensory.
The mushroom contains a chemical which is most promising for the further investigation of extrasensory perception.
When this program began, the question was, were the claims for the mushroom true or false? Well, for those of us who made the journey, the answer is true.
So you think you know how the mind works?
You know, we don't know how our own brains work.
Where's the mind? Where would you say the mind is? In the brain? In the spirit? In the gallbladder? Where's the mind in the body? When all these things, oh, mind, you mean the brain? No, no, the mind.
We don't even know how our brain conjures up an image of what is objectively outside our heads. You know, when the photons hit the retina, they don't go inside the brain. What actually happens is that information, that photon bombardment, is transduced into electrochemical information that is then decoded and classified and categorized back here at the back of the head where the visual cortex is. And then somehow that information, which is deconstructed into color, movement, depth, is reconstructed into an image that looks to me that it's outside my head, but it's actually being concocted inside my brain. We don't know how our brain creates a 3D color image inside the brain that looks like it's outside. We don't know how we see objective reality.
In humans, the old parts of the brain oversee emotion and help build memories. They control heart rate and breathing. They also form intimate connections with the new brain, the cortex. Though less than a quarter inch thick, the cortex is the brain's crowning glory. Among its roles, the cortex is our reality check. It filters and orders the outside world for us and allows us to see, touch, hear, and speak. The cortex is also the human thinking cap. All our plans, thoughts, and ideas originate in this layer. The cortex is packed with nerve cells. About two-thirds of all our neurons operate here. A piece of cortex tissue, no larger than a pinhead, can house 30,000 of these cells. Each neuron has a job, to communicate with other neurons. The brain works by forming networks among these cells. The long, spiny branches of the networks create a neural forest of astounding intricacy. Neurons use these communication lines to talk to each other with electric and chemical signals. Here under microscope are two neurons linking up. Though it may look like they fuse together, neurons don't actually touch each other. A closer look reveals that a tiny gap called the synapse separates their branches. This is where a message passes from one neuron to the next. The message comes from here, small sacs that store chemical molecules. When stimulated, these sacs release their molecules which cross the cell membrane into the synaptic gap. An electric zap allows this to happen. Meantime, the receiving neuron has special welcome sites for the incoming molecules. These receptor sites bind with the molecules. When they do, special gates open up. The gates let in a flood of charged particles, sodium and potassium ions, which start up a new electrical signal in the receiving neuron. This simple chain of events, an electrical zap, followed by chemical changes, followed by another electrical zap, is the basis of all brain activity. It's how neurons speak to each other. Here, then, is the key to the brain's complexity. There are 100 billion neurons in the brain. Each neuron, like a bit player in a grand production, processes its information, then hooks up with as many as 50,000 other neurons to send and receive messages. 100 billion neurons times 50,000 connections. It's this complexity that allows us to think imaginatively. On their own, neurons aren't very bright. but put 100 billion of them together in a small space and let them all start talking to each other, and you start to get brainstorms. The trillions of neural networks, like an improvisational orchestra, create new ideas and connect different thoughts in a whimsical and sometimes inspired fashion. It's this impromptu ability to produce new things in our brains that allows us to progress, that quite simply takes us from here to here.
If we take a look at that brain, there it is, the white matter, sending information in and out of the gray area, which is the cortices, that for all practical purposes, consciousness is a closed loop. We have all this information going up into the cortex, but really, if we think at it quantitatively, only about 20% of the input to our cortex is sensory. All the rest of it is talk or interactions between those neurons, which means that consciousness is a closed loop, and sensory input is just a minor modification. Consciousness is actually created by this loop that is activated once every approximately 20 milliseconds with a phase modulation of about 12 milliseconds. That means if we change the neurochemistry within the cortices, we change the way you experience the world, we change your consciousness. If we change the neurochemistry within the cortices, we change the way you experience the world, we change your consciousness.